Everything set up and Cheryl's ready to go. Okay, excellent. 6:05, I call to order the Gearhart Planning Commission meeting. All of the commission members are here and staff. We have Carol Connell and Chad Sweet and Cheryl appearing as municipal court. So we have a consent agenda, a minute, the financial report. Is there any further correspondence, Cheryl? Is there any further correspondence? Does anyone know?
I don't know, but I'll go check with Cheryl here real quick.
Okay, we don't have anything, so I think we've got everything.
There's a revised site plan that came in this afternoon.
Right, but we've got that.
Okay.
So we won't be able to hear you.
So do I have a motion?
I can't even unmute.
Fail to detect your microphone. Please make sure. Say cancel.
Assume.
You can't because you don't have a microphone on this.
Anyway, yeah, there's no correspondence.
Say aye.
Sorry.
Aye.
All opposed, say nay.
Don't change anything, Chad.
We have reports from the staff. Carol, you're the one I can see. Would you like to start?
I wouldn't change anything.
I don't have a report. I have enough to say later.
Okay, thank you.
Oh, man. That's okay.
Cheryl, Chad, do you have anything to report? You've gone.
Okay, so...
Go ahead and see it. Maybe it'll
go ahead and go to unmute.
I can see a pencil.
And you'll be able to talk. It won't be on camera.
Okay, sorry. What was the question, Virginia? I'm having audio trouble.
Okay, my question to you earlier was there any additional correspondence we need to be aware of?
No additional correspondence, and nothing came in after 4:00 for either public hearing tonight.
Okay, all right. Awesome. Thank you. And Chad, do you have anything to report to us tonight?
No, not at this time. Thank you, Jim.
Not at this time. Okay. Commissioners, are there any things the commissioners would like to tell us about tonight?
Okay, wait. You have something at the end, the commissioners' concerns, right?
Right. Okay, you've got a concern for at the end of the meeting, right, Terry? Yeah, okay. All right, we have a goals list. We do have the goals list this month. As you remember, last month we didn't have it in our packet. Finding it. Okay. Are there any changes to this from what we've seen in the last couple of months, Carol?
No, I would just say you're looking at one tonight, and that is under zoning ordinance amendment considerations, the last one, priority 2, consider adding riparian protection standards to the parks and open space zone. That's going to be discussed tonight in your park plan hearing.
Okay.
Other than that, we're still working a lot on the Highway 101 safety improvement plan. Keep your eyes peeled for updates that might be on the blog, city blog, because it's moving right along toward the design.
Is the conduct a community vision citizen involvement program to update the plan a new edition? I don't remember seeing that before.
And it's non-prioritized.
I think it's old.
It's basically under number 1 for priority and item, so.
No, the one is on the fire station. There's nothing under that one. And I actually think that was left over from the last planner, maybe 10 years ago.
Yeah, it's the first time I remember seeing it on here, so I don't know if it's just an old template that got added in.
I, you know, things happen, but I think that's always been there.
David has two comments on the goals.
Yeah, David.
First is item number one, the conference of plan update considerations. The item that is listed as priority three, explore accessory dwelling unit provisions. I would suggest we move that up to two, because we're going to start seeing that coming along. I'm already hearing talk about it now in the mail. Second thing I have to say is under item two, zoning ordinance amendment considerations. The third line down, which is a priority three, evaluate standards to protect residential areas from commercial development. I would suggest we move that to at least a priority number two, rather than three, because that's going to keep happening now that the development on the highway is starting to kick in with all those for sales and opportunities. So that's my two cents.
Okay. Do I have any comment on David's suggestions?
I agree with both of them.
Okay. Russ or Austin?
I would agree as well.
Yeah, I think number two makes sense.
Okay. Evaluate the standards to protect residential areas from commercial development. Move it to a priority two.
I agree.
Okay.
And that is discussed in the CUP we're looking at for the Barrett's property.
Okay. And then he suggested taking the explore accessory dwelling unit ADU provisions. We really haven't talked about that much, and you wanted to move that to a two also, David? Did I get that right?
That's my recommendation, yes.
Okay. The Conduct Community Vision Citizen Involvement Program to update the plan, it's been on there.
For a long time,
because I look back at previous ones, and it's been in there. So, it's been in there for a long time.
It's a little bit broad, if you don't mind my stepping in. And we've updated the comprehensive plan several times since that was listed as a goal. So it's an interesting, I guess the question is more like, do we want to start a community visioning process? Or do we like our vision?
I like our vision.
I know that our neighbor to the south, Seaside, has done a visioning process twice in the last 15 years. The first vision went no place, and I'm not too sure where the second vision is going either. So it's a complicated process, to say the least. So shall we move explore accessory dwelling unit provisions up to number two?
Yes.
Agree?
Yes.
Okay, we'll move it up to two. Got that, Carol?
Got it.
All right. Thank you, David, for your input.
Thank you, everybody.
Okay, so moving on. This is a time for visitors to make comments about anything that is not on the agenda tonight. If any of the visitors want to say something, please unmute yourself and speak now. Not hearing anything. Sharon, did you have something or?
No.
No, okay. All right, so let's move on. We have two public hearings tonight. And as you all know, I have a statement I get to read. So I'm going to open the public hearings. We have two of them. 21-05 CU, 6-plex multifamily residence, and 21-404, sorry, CP.VTA Gearhart Parks and Recreation Master Plan. I've opened the public hearing. Now I need to read a disclosure statement. This disclosure statement will cover both public hearings. I am not going to read it twice tonight. All persons testifying shall be deemed parties to the application and must provide their name and full mailing address if they wish to be notified of the decision, continuances, appeals, or other procedural actions required by the code. The city zoning code specifies applicable criteria to be relied upon in making a decision. Those criteria and findings of fact are in the city staff report. Public testimony should be limited to those criteria and findings of fact or to other city or state land use standards that the person testifying believes apply to the proposed land use action. Failure to raise an issue in person or in writing with sufficient detail to afford the hearing body and parties to the hearing an opportunity to respond to that issue precludes appeal to the City Council or Land Use Board of Appeals or to seek damages in circuit court due to a condition of approval. Before the conclusion of the initial evidentiary hearing, any participant may ask the Planning Commission for an opportunity to present additional relevant evidence, arguments, or testimony that is within the scope of the hearing. The hearing body shall grant the request by scheduling a date to finish the hearing, the continuance, to a time and date certain, or by leaving the record open for additional evidence, argument, or testimony pursuant to ORS 197.763-6A through E. Any of the commissioners, do you have a conflict of interest, an ex parte contact, or personal bias?
No.
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 No. Okay, that's good. Does the audience have any challenges to the commission's ability to make an impartial decision? Hearing none, I will respond. We will have the staff report from Carol Connell on the first one, the 6-plex multifamily residence. After she is done, the applicant may make their presentation. After that, then we will have opponents speak, and any neutral comments, and if needed, the applicant's rebuttal. I ask that anyone speaking as a proponent or opponent keep their comments to no more than 3 minutes to move us on along today. So first, Carol, it's time for your staff report.
Thank you, Madam President. Okay, I hope you all have had a chance to look at the report. There have been trailing pieces come in at the last minute, and forgive me for that, but we're always trying to get all the possible questions answered before you meet, and it's, you know, there are a lot of details here that we're trying to work out ahead of time, so you don't have to watch us try and work it out. This is a conditional use permit to construct a 6-unit residential building in a C2 zone. And the property is 4217 North Highway 101. It's a 0.64 acre site. And just for location, it's on the east side of the highway, across from the liquor store and whatever else stores are there, Grandma's and probably a marijuana store there too. So it's pretty directly across from that site. It's been residential use. until a new owner, I believe, purchased the price. They're removing the manufactured home that's there and proposing to put a sixplex on it. Just to make sure we have this, well, maybe I'll wait till Chad's going to help me put some of these exhibits up. But the new one, the new site plan dated yesterday, is I think you all got it, and we can use that one. There it is. Master of the exhibits. Thank you. So that'll be an important talking point. And then we don't have to show this other one yet, but the two photos of the existing road that I think I took me twice to, thank you, Chad, to get those to you. I duplicated another document earlier, thought it was these. So there's the road. And you can see Yankee Traders there on the right. And the property is on the left. That giant tree is right where that building will be. But there are several other nice big trees that will be preserved. But this photo is very telling because we have, you know, probably the biggest issue tonight is what to do with the road. And so we'll get to that. But you can see it looks like almost as much, I think the pink mark is the property line. And so there's much of it on the Yankee Trader side, and I know the Yankee Trader uses the driveway to get onto the highway, not necessarily all the time, but sometimes. And then I think the road goes all the way back to the Pershing property, and that's where they come out. Okay. Exhibits that comments from the staff. There were no fire concerns. There were parking questions. Building inspector had no concerns, subject to code compliance, and there'll be quite a bit of building inspection of the building later if it's approved. The police chief had parking comments and no parking signage recommendation. The public works had water comments, and city manager had parking concerns. Clatsop County had no comments, and that is it. And we can go into those in more detail if you like. Let's see, the zoning criteria listed there for you, and I don't normally talk about this very much, but you can see we've got a commercial zone. So that's an interesting part of this because commercial zones don't always allow multifamily housing, but in Gearhart, they do. And so to me that, in this C2 zone, that means really it's the only place we allow them. Well, except for R3, and that's more like the condo kind of zoning. But there must have been in the early days in this plan an intentional reason to put them in the C2 zone, which is the highway zone. So there's some logic to it because there's already a lot of residential on the highway, and there's pockets of commercial, and then there's scattered commercial. So it seems the plan has always anticipated a mix. But I don't know, not in decades has there been a multiplex built, I don't think. Okay, and then the transportation improvements and access management chapter of the zoning code, Article 4, is important here. And so is the off-street parking. Because it comes out of the transportation system plan work that was done, which is a recent update to the kind of policies the city had before when it comes to transportation planning and improvements and access management. I just wanted you to know that the standards we will be talking about a little bit tonight doesn't seem like they were required in the old days, and they weren't. Probably because many of these properties were in the county and the standards were quite different. They were rural. And the city never updated their sort of legal abilities to require improvements when there were greater impacts. Okay. So the property has three large trees. I'm on page two. I'm just going to try to get back on and try and get right to the key points if I can. There's a large cedar tree on the north property line, the large pine tree on the east property line that the applicant's planning to save. The large fir and the two maples are in or near the building envelope and they will be removed. Access from the highway was provided by a 25-foot wide, 900-foot-long access and utility easement when the land was divided in 2005, and that's when it was in the county, and that's how the partition came about, was by a county approval.
And, excuse me, Carol?
Yeah.
What page are you on so I can follow a little closer?
Two.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, and I think it's a good idea because I skip around, but I try and...
Because I make notes on these pages as I can.
Okay, so we're still up on site information. That particular access easement also serves two adjoining parcels to the east. And I did speak to Mr. Pershing yesterday. I think he owns them both. He doesn't live there. It must be rented. And anyway... the access and utility easement has a gravel surface, which we now see on the photos. And just so you know, there's some potholes where the gravel gets closer to the highway and, you know, cars have to accelerate a bit to get in, to get out, so that it just, you know, requires maintenance. The drive at the end of this piece terminates in a half of a hammerhead turnaround, and that would be for emergency vehicles or just individuals finding a place to turn around at the very east end of this structure. And then the east half is on the adjoining parcel. So there's an anticipation that the lot behind this one, east of this one, it will develop someday. And I wouldn't be surprised when this goes up, people start getting ideas. The other half of that hammerhead turnaround will be finished on at that time. There's a fire hydrant at the northeast corner of the property. The site's pretty flat, and that the problem with that is that it's easy to build on, but there's some drainage runoff problems. And the parcel and that part of the highway is in the medium tsunami scenario, and it is therefore subject to some density limitations in this report. The surrounding uses include a daycare on the north, a residence to the east, the Yankee Trader to the south, and the highway to the west. There's two water services to the site. There's an existing 6-foot fence on the east property line. There's a 4-foot chain link fence on the east portion of the abutting north parcel. There's no fencing proposed on this project. The additional applicant proposes adding landscaping between the driveways in the septic system area on the west side of the property and in the open space on the east side of the property, as well as landscaping adjoining the highway. The applicant's elevation drawings, I don't know if you have those, Chad, but I think you should, yeah. Let's see. We can come back to this and I'll keep going, but I don't know where Chad went. The applicant's elevation drawings are prepared by Sunrise Homes and they illustrate 6 two-story dwellings in a single structure. The building materials are composition roof, hardy plank siding, aluminum windows. Two-story floor plan includes one car garage, a bath, a great room, a kitchen, a dining on the first floor, and 2 bedrooms and 2 baths on the second floor. The exterior includes parking stall in the driveway, a walkway, and landscaping in the front yard. The primary and backup septic system areas are on the west side of the parcel, and that real estate is pretty critical to making this work for that many units. So putting things on that septic drain field or too much pavement or anything that would be negatively, would negatively impact the system is not a good idea. The exterior, I mentioned that again, additional landscaping, I already said that. Okay, so one thing that I learned from Mr. Pershing is that hammerhead design is stated to be 25 on the site plan, but it's, according to Bob Pershing, who lives there, he thinks it's 22 feet, and that might be debatable. We referred this to ODOT and the county. County had no objections, and we've been back and forth with the ODOT, which I'll talk about later, on what to do here. Okay, the request is allows a triplex or a multifamily dwelling, and the applicant actually started out with three or two triplexes, I think he started out with. And, you know, again, with the fairly small size and the large requirement for a septic system, I think that was more economical and just physically better to attach the whole thing and make it a sixplex. So you see those one-car garages, and the units are two stories. And, you know, there's not quite enough drawings for me to see, but I'm sure there's some articulation in this, what looks like a flat facade. But I imagine the bedrooms there upstairs come out. I use a little bit of explanation that from the applicant. So, okay, now Chad, you might want to go back to the, let's go back to the site plan, if we can. Now, in the C2 zone, how do you determine all the residential aspects of this? Actually, I was thinking the aerial's good, but when you get back to the drawing that has all the details, that's good too. And this, you know, you can see the building to be removed, and that's towards the back. And then you can see what looks like half the hammerhead's kind of in there. Then there's 3001 and 3002. 3001 has access to the easement, and I'm assuming 3002 does all the way out to the highway. Yeah, thank you. So the C2 zone says that if you're going to build a residential structure in a multifamily, you use the R3 standards. And so page 3, which, forgive us, we put now it says page 4 there. 3 and 4 got, oh, there's this, I forgot to tell you this. Page 3 and 4 got mistakenly put in the wrong order. And so there's all the agency comments on page 3, which is after page 4. And maybe I'll go back and just mention an update to those. On yesterday, the ODOT finally said, it's too hard for us to pin down what exactly the design will be on the highway. You can see on the plan here that 10-foot landscape area that is also right now a utility easement, so it's set aside currently as a utility easement. Eventually, what you'll be seeing out on the highway is a walkway, like a swale buffer drainage, and a bike trail on this side of the highway. And in trying to figure out how to talk about that now and to correlate it with this project, it's just too difficult. But the beauty is that 10-foot easement is commonly, that kind of easement is commonly used with ODOT with improvements and sidewalk, for instance, in this case. And so as you'll find at the end of the staff report, there's a recommendation that there be some right-of-way dedicated, but that we everybody decided to not take that out. So at this time, we recommend no requirement for any more right-of-way dedication or any more public easement widening that 10 foot to basically 12 or 15 it might have gone to. It's just too early to tell, but it will go a long way to match up what I think will be the eventual design. I think what in these public the city comments, I would just point out mainly the police there thinks that Lamont Lane will need to be posted no parking on the north side. And like others, his concern is there's no way that people will have one vehicle in the garage and one in the driveway. He said that just won't happen. Where will the visitors park? Probably on the south side of Lamont, but as we know now, that's being used as a driveway to other businesses and uses there. So the south side is not the, really the responsibility of this owner. And we'll talk more about parking because parking is a question, but Gearhart has pretty strict, I mean, large requirements for parking spaces compared to the rest of the world. All right, and so now back to page four, which is going backwards. The lot size, density, front yard, side yard, rear yard, height restrictions, lot coverage findings are all there. And I'm not gonna go through them all because it's too much detail right now. And the applicant and I have spent a long time working on this plan to make sure all these requirements are met, and they are. Okay, so unless you find something that doesn't look right, which we can talk about when I'm finished, and when the applicant's finished. The moving on to the plan zone provisions, tsunami zone, page five. I would only point that out because we haven't used this very many times, and it's a new policy that the city does restrict high density in the worst case scenario zones of a tsunami. That being small, medium, large, extra large, extra extra large being the worst case. But in this case, what we ended up with when we adopted these tsunami policies is that high density housing should be limited in the M magnitude area on those maps. And that would limit this, that would limit any multifamily housing, 10 dwelling units per acre maximum. So with the gross site being 28,283 square feet or 6.4 acres, the city finds that the 0.64 acre site is allowed to have a total of 6.4 dwelling units, and the proposal is for six. So I was very happy that that worked out that way, because this is the first test. And, you know, for a lot of other reasons, these units are important to build. Okay, let's see, estimate. Except for single family duplex, they all, hold on here. Well, evacuation routes, while we're still there, a new multifamily residence is required to incorporate evacuation route improvements as part of any new development in compliance with the TSP. And so this six unit structure will house an estimated 2.3 people per household based on the housing study done in the county, or 14 persons in the sixplex. And there are two existing or planned evacuation routes nearest to the subject site, west on Long Highway 101 and east along a trestle drive that ties into Railroad Avenue. Of course, Highway 101 is the logical place to go right now if there's an event, And you know, there's nothing out there yet. It's in the planning stages and it won't be too long, but anyway, there is a need to eventually have these connecting pieces of evacuation routes to help people escape. And it, on foot is going to be the recommended way in the most case, because the roads will be so messed up. That plan's in the works, and that highway plan will have those kinds of facilities, and we'll be dealing with that later. So Trestle Drive is a second option as a future pedestrian route, and but the occupants don't have legal access across the two private properties to reach that eventual trail route, and the trail itself is a long ways from actually being built. Okay, so then that zone is met. Now, this is the section of transportation improvements that I think is going to be the topic of greatest concern tonight by the applicants. So I want to make sure, since we haven't used it before for a situation like this, that you understand what our policies are. Transportation improvement requirements are applicable to new development if the development fronts a street segment that is planned for a sidewalk or a trail. And the both the overlay zone of Tsunami and the TSP requires highway frontage and evacuation route improvements unless the city manager waives, defers, or requires a fee in lieu of the improvements according to that section of improving existing streets. So going along on this topic, every lot shall abut a street for at least 25 feet. So they've got 100 feet on the highway. And let's see, the subject property abuts the highway, and Lamont Lane is an approved highway approach. So that's already been approved by ODOT, but there's this pending plan that will have improvements I discussed earlier. And the parking lot, which is a good thing in terms of visuals and aesthetics, does not face the highway. It actually faces Lamont, so the layout has worked well. And the proposal is a change of use, so that ODOT was notified in their comments, if you know what they are. So down to 4.040, the applicability of these next improvements apply to a multifamily development to construct transportation improvements in accordance with the standards procedures of this chapter. All transportation improvements required or voluntary shall conform to the Gearhart TSP. So we know that the improvement plan's coming, and we tried to make that, to figure that out now, but that will not happen now, so there's no right-of-way required. But no building permit shall be issued until all required street improvements are in place and approved by the city manager or designee, or otherwise bonded, and shall be proportional to the impact of the development on public facilities. Findings in the development approval shall indicate how the improvements directly relate to and are roughly proportional to the impact of the development. So the city finds the highway sidewalk improvements adjoining the site should be coordinated with ODOT. Regarding Lamont Lane, the city finds the increased impact of six new multifamily dwellings, and 14 new residents will have a significant impact on the existing graveled surface of Lamont Lane. Therefore, the street should be improved to the city's narrowest. It's not a big improvement. It's the narrowest standard that we have because it's a dead-end street. It's not ever going to be a through street. The improvement should be limited to a half-street standard in anticipation of the southern half being the obligation of future development on those adjoining parcels. And this is very common. Some people say, well, how can you do a half street? But it happens all the time. It ends up being a little more than a half just to make the alignment and the travel path adequate. But in the city's case, we don't have sidewalks and we don't have curbs hardly anywhere. And this is simply paving for the maintenance, long-term maintenance, and of this, and this is the beginning of an area that's going to have future development, that the rest of the street will be picked up by those adjoining properties. If we don't do it associated with the impact, which is these six plexes here, then it'll never be done by another property owner. It's the obligation of the developer here to pay the street. And we've got this 25-foot wide easement. It does bring access to those two eastern parcels. Anything that is extended will have the same requirement. But with those six units, 7.3 trips per day per unit, according to the transportation or the International Transportation Manual 10th edition, that'll be 44 new daily trips on that road than there are now. Actually, there would have been 44. The applicant should be required to pave a 20-foot portion of the easement. It's possible the road will be widened by the redevelopment of the Yankee Trader in the future and in the rear parcels later. Now, we do have this waiver, deferral, and fee in lieu option if the city manager finds that that could be used. But because of the increased number of trips, there's clearly a proportional impact here that's the requirement. That's the only way it'll ever happen. Somebody else is not going to pave it, some other property owner, and it sets the stage for future developments like this. And think of it as not too different from all those subdivisions that dead end off the highway, that come off the highway, go in and serve several houses, and all those streets are paved. Okay. Going through the rest of this is a lot to do with transportation, and let's see. I wondered, based on those aerial or those photos, if there should be a reciprocal easement considered to Yankee Trader, and I'm just not sure what the applicant thinks about that or how that would even work. It just dawned on me a little while ago. But otherwise, the second transportation related issue here, the applicant has agreed to do, and that's the requirement on page 9 for pedestrian access and circulation and bike parking. The development shall conform to all pedestrian access and circulation standards of this section. And so one is a continuous walkway system throughout the site. And the site is small, of course. And so this sounds grandiose and it really doesn't end up being a huge impact here. But the applicant has, and Chad, would you mind putting up the site plan again? The October 13th site plan with this driveways and the street and you can see a walkway, a 4-foot walkway goes into every doorway from the parking lot. So that's the first part of a adjacent connecting sidewalk. And then the second part would be having a walkway to the highway, because the number of people here and the services across the street, and ask the police chief, and I've done it a few times, you try and run across the highway on your way to go get something and see if you make it. That's just one thing, like getting across is the hard part, but eventually this walkway will connect to the sidewalk, which eventually will show some safe crossings interspersed. I don't know where yet, but anyway, it's a dry spot. It's ADA compliant. There could easily be a handicapped person in one of those units, and it's required by the code. So they agreed, and that's why the plan came late. they being the owner, and Dale, their consultants, I think owns the property right now, but anyway, they put this in, and it links, you know, the building and all the units to the highway and to the street. And the second part thing that it does there is they've added, if we think we need it, because they do certainly satisfy the required parking of 2 spaces per unit, they've added these 2 gravel parking slots that are informal, and the gravel will help with the drainage rather than adding more pavement to both ends of the parking lot for overflow. So again, we're recommending an asphalted Lamont Lane, and we don't know exactly the specifications yet, but the staff and the applicant would work that out as we get the project moves forward. Okay, moving right along. The other issues that end up being noteworthy when you build something like this is outdoor lighting, signage, clear vision, maintenance of setback and open space, and off-street parking. And those are all listed on page 10. And 3 of those turn out to be conditions of approval that would be associated with their building permit when they get that far. Some of these are just the fine-tuning aspects of a development. Off-street parking, I think we'll just cover that for a minute. The parking spaces shall, the section requires compliance for new use when a use is changed, so we have that. And the spaces shall be 9 by 18, except if they have compact, they can be a little bit smaller, 8 by 16 for up to 50% of the spaces. But they're just going straight to the 9 by 18 full size. I think that's good. And each unit has 2 parking spaces. Just so you know, some places are going to no parking requirements. I mean, I know that's Portland, but not everything's Portland, but even smaller towns are trying to reduce the cost of building these units because the cost is affected by the number of parking spaces. And that's why I put in this page 12, parking cost to build ends up raising the rent. So it costs, now this may not be the case for this project because this is just asphalt, it's not concrete, it's doesn't have curbs, it's a pretty small space area. But it, just so you know, it costs typically $5,000 per surface space. And cost for, we're not doing above ground and below ground. Typical cost for renters that raises the rent by an estimated $142. And additional cost of a unit's rent attributed to parking is 17%. Now, I'm just showing that to you as the far end of this topic. You know, they're putting into, it is this kind of tandem arrangement where somebody has to get in the garage that comes home first so that the other person can park behind, and that's tricky to pull that off every day. And as somebody was saying, garages end up being storage. And so, yeah, I mean, I think they've got the minimum. They've agreed to add some 4 more on the edges that are gravel so it doesn't get too much pervious surface. And that's where we are in the parking, even though some of the staff were concerned. Okay, the bulk of the rest of this report are your approval criteria. The first one has to do with comprehensive plan policies, and I mean, I can hardly find a plan policy that this doesn't comply with, and I'm not going to go through them all, but because there are no real conflicts in terms of the plan policies we see everywhere we're trying to create decent, affordable housing for all residents of the city, and needed housing besides the single family, multifamily, manufactured housing types are needed, and that's, this is a, meeting that goal. The city will prevent the city from becoming a tourist destination, so, you know, the housing in the commercial zone is providing a new opportunities for people to live as opposed to what could be there in a commercial zone and a tourist related use. There's already a residential around both to, at least to the east and the south of the site, and this residential, so it's compatible with that. It's a new opportunity because we know we don't have units like this. Reduces the amount of trips in and out of places by being near commercial uses. It's attached housing, provides increased energy efficiencies and lower cost common wall construction. There's just hardly anything you can say against this project as a conditional use in a commercial zone. And is there a demand? That's the second criterion, and I think we just went through that. Yes, there's a demand. We've been hearing about it for a long time. Is this a good location? Yes, it's a good location. It's already fairly low density of residential in the area with mixed commercial, but it's compatible with what's there. It won't generate excessive traffic like a commercial use could if you went that way. Are there adequate facilities there? Yes, there are adequate sewer, water, fire, building services, as long as they meet all the standards, get all the details right. Are there topography problems and soil problems? No, it's flat, and they've done the due diligence on the DEQ permitting to ensure that there's permeability and so on for the septic systems. Site is an adequate area, and layout is good with all the required elements. I think we could say yes, it's tight, but there's a nice amount of open space. It's not right on the highway, it's set back from the highway. The owner of the property will be also the manager, so that's a great plus. There's a landscape buffer on the highway planned, and all the elements are there. The only thing it might be missing is a bicycle rack, and if we could get one, I think it would be used. So there's no reason to increase the height or limit the height or increase the street width or control the number of access points or increase the parking, although they did. There's no reason to limit the number, size, location of signs, so it's too early for signage discussion. So in conclusion, the use is a great need and opportunity and a good place to have it here, and the staff supports it, and I think the comprehensive plan does too. So starting on page 18, there's a number of conditions that I'll just run through as my last bit here. The applicant, number one, should provide the city with a copy of the septic system approval from DEQ and modify the plan to illustrate a waterline utility easement width and location to be approved by city water. Modify the plans to address specific highway landscaping requirements in section 6.070 and a landscape plan for the open spaces, including mostly native plant species and no noxious weeds. The applicant shall modify the plans to include an ADA compliant 5-foot sidewalk from the structure to the highway north of Lamont, which they did and just arrived yesterday. A paved half street to 3/4, I'm slipping that 3/4 in because I can't be promised exactly what the dimensions are. Improvement on Lamont Lane, including the half hammerhead section and marked parallel, oh, never mind, take out that, oops. Originally had some parallel parking for extras, period. Pave the half street improvement on Lamont Lane, including the hammerhead section, taking out and marked parallel parking space on the north side outside the clear vision triangle that has to be designated. So you, when people, cars pull out, there's nothing blocking their view on both directions on to the highway. And then a detailed street design specifications to be agreed upon by the applicant and the city. Condition number four is there'll be a revised plan to show dedication to ODOT. I'm recommending you strike that one altogether. And those first three conditions then, if you would agree to strike number four, would be prior to issuance of any permit. So these would be the essential things to kind of wrap up before he goes for a building permit. And so then prior to issuance of the building permit, file a sign permit if you want to install a sign on the highway, but it can't be in the right of way. And the required to provide a bicycle rack with a minimum of 3 spaces accessible to all residents. Outdoor lighting fixtures and exterior building lighting fixtures should be shielded or recessed into the fixture or building design to avoid casting glare onto adjacent property or upward into the sky. Fourth, a 15-foot clear vision triangle at the intersection of Lamont Lane and Highway 101 shall not contain parking, plantings, fencing, structures, or other or temporary permanent obstruction exceeding 2.5 feet, so on. And then the last one is to consider providing a picnic table and benches in the open space area on the east side of the parcel. So I think with that, I will say that's as much as I can relay at the moment, and that's our recommendation. We turn it over to the chair, who might then call on the applicant.
Okay, thank you, Carol. Were there any specific questions from the commissioners on anything that was not clear to you in Carol's presentation? Hearing nothing, the applicant. Is the applicant still here?
Yes.
There you are. Sorry. You're at the top of my screen. Okay. Would you like to make a presentation? This is your chance to speak or share anything else you'd like to tell us.
Yes. Dale Barrett, 4253A Highway 1, excuse me, that's the office one, 34107 West Campbell Loop, Seaside, Oregon. The owners of the property are Technical Enterprises, which were myself and actually Ron Larson, who's also on this Zoom meeting, and another owner, we're own it as Technical Enterprises. So we had the engineering office there. We've since leased it out for a daycare, and we have would like to get the conditional use for this property.
Uh-oh.
He froze.
Dang it.
Dale, you froze. Ron Larson, you're still there.
Yes, I am. I don't know what happened other than technical difficulties, as we all know.
Do you want to continue? Do you know what he was going to say?
Not exactly. but he gave just a very brief history. This property, when Technical Enterprises purchased it more than 20 years ago, almost 20 years ago, I guess it was, in 2005, there were 3 manufactured homes on the property. And so they were providing that residential need, which is obviously common in Gerhard. And so 2 of them were, they were getting old, quite honestly. They did not have very good septic drain fields, if any. Some of them were very, very grandfathered in for whatever they were. And so over time, as those individuals moved out, we tore down those buildings. And there's only one left, but it has not had a resident in it in a couple of years now. So I think that that's a really good use of the property that's already been established and would be able to continue, even though it is the commercial zone. I'm not sure what else Dale was going to say. I think that we also have the potential developer, the proposed developer, Carrie Johnson, is available on phone. Carrie, did you want to have anything to say regarding those conditions of approval? And Carrie,
good evening, everyone. This is Carrie Johnson. I'm a prospective buyer of this property, and I've been just listening in here. And Dale Barrett's in the process of trying to get logged back on, so hopefully he'll be back with us shortly here. Generally, I'm in agreement with most of the staff report. We have a few concerns that I think Dale's going to try to address. One thing I can talk about is on the front elevation of the building, there were some questions there about it looked two-dimensional. Well, there are steps in the front of the building. There are dormers, there are covered porches, there are pop-outs. So it's not as, it doesn't have a flat front across the front. And also I heard that we are proposing vinyl windows, not aluminum, just a clarification on that one. We've added some additional parking. I think that as the potential owner, I can control the tenants' parking, and we have some guest parking that we have that meet some additional requirements. So for the most part, we're in agreement, but we have some concerns about the road, and I'm hoping Dale will get back on and talk about some of those things. So that's about all for me.
Okay, I am going to throw a question to either Carrie or Ron. Dale Barrett is the one that has put in the application for it. So I believe Carrie just said that she's buying it. So who is actually getting the permit?
Dale Barrett is the applicant for this conditional use permit. And if this conditional use permit is approved, depending on what the conditions are, and I will be the one that a purchase would go through on this property, and I would be applying for the building permits. So I've been working with Dale Barrett on that portion of it. But Dale Barrett is, or the Technical Enterprises is the applicant here.
And the reason for that is that Dale and I are the two members of Technical Enterprises. And so we felt it was best to have a conditional use that goes with the property. We are the property owners. And then depending on how the conditions of approval go, then Carrie, we have a sales agreement. One of the contingencies is the approval of the conditional use. And then if it is approved by the city, that would go with the land, and the new owner would be able to have those conditions. That's why he's with us tonight.
Okay. And I see Dale is alive again. you froze on us.
I don't know. Something disconnected. Who knows what?
That's okay. Ron and Carrie have spoke to us in your absence, explained a little bit of the history. But like Ron said, he didn't know what you were going to say. Is there anything else you would like to say?
Yeah, there is a couple things. First, just very quickly on three comments on Carol's presentation of the staff report. Just clarification, she indicated the access road was 900 feet long. Actually, Lamont Lane is only 392 feet. It only goes to the rear portion of the Pershing property, the second or lot right behind us. I think that's tax lot 3001. And then the hammerhead, if you look on the official plat recorded, is 25 foot wide in its right of way. Mr. Pershing may be talking about a gravel surface that's already there that's only 22 feet, I'm not sure, but it is 25 on the official plat. And probably most importantly, if Chad could possibly get the site plan back up that we looked at. Carol, you said there were only two additional parking spaces that we had. There's actually four that we had added in on that site plan.
I think I said four and one time, but I knew there were four, as one at each end, but we couldn't see the other end.
I think that was really important. I wanted to make sure the commissioners understood that we've added actually four additional ones in there. Okay. So then moving on from that, I wanted to remind everyone that Lamont Lane is actually a private easement. It isn't a public street. It was never dedicated to the public. So it was created according to the county road standards at that time for a partition of three lots, and that's what we had done. So consequently, there is a road maintenance agreement that road is maintained by the technical enterprise ownership, and the Pershings back behind. There's no one south of that, the Yankee Trader or the other private residents that back there. While they may use it, they have an easement on the south side of the Yankee Trader that is their access. If they're coming across the road here, they really don't have a right to, and they don't have any responsibility to keep it maintained, even though they may be using it some. So we haven't really talked to them about that much. So, all right, so the parking situation, I don't know. Our preference is to have the 20-foot wide road, which I went out and measured the gravel that was on that road out there. And even though the photos that I show a gravel, as you indicated, Carol, most of it is on the Yankee Trader side, but there is 20 foot of gravel on our side of the road. There's some grass growing over the edge of it, but I took a metal probe and probed around and could feel the gravel underneath it. There were four residences on this property historically when we bought the property. So there is quite a bit of gravel in there, and it, you know, that can get cleaned up because you're gonna wanna clean it up. And then we have agreed that we could put sidewalk from the right of way out to the edge of the where the walks come down from the sixplex that's coming sidewalk there. So two reasons why we prefer the gravel over pavement. We're trying to keep the hard surface such as asphalt and concrete to as much of a minimum as we can, so we don't increase the runoff of the water and add to the problem that ODOT's got. They have an inadequate drainage there on the east side of the highway, as we all know. When you drive through, you've got that puddle of water when it's really raining hard. The more hard surface we put on there, the more runoff we would have, which could add to that, and we don't want to do that. So we have agreed on the site plan that we revised and resubmitted yesterday to have about a 50-foot paved apron out, because you need that to be able to keep, as Carol indicated, there were some potholes out towards the front, because as the cars take off, they spin their wheels a little bit trying to go out with the faster speeds there. So if we have that paved, that would eliminate that problem there. But we also are hoping to keep our costs down, to keep these units as affordable as we can. As we all know, there's that huge need for the housing. This is not short-term housing. It's not a second home for somebody that's only going to be here, 30 days out of the year. It's going to be for permanent housing of people that work here, live here, and we have a with Cary being a local builder, we think that this is the way to go. Okay, let's see. We have agreed that we wouldn't necessarily want any parking on Lamont Lane. At a 20-foot wide road surface, it really doesn't lend itself for parking. So there would be no problem that we could post that, no parking. But even more so, talking to Cary, who he's the builder, he's going to be the long-term owner. This is an investment for him. And he can control some of the parking through his rental agreement when they sign it, that they have the two parking spaces assigned to them, one that's in the garage and the one that's in the front of it. And then the extras that we've added out should be left open for visitors and that type of thing. But that's very controllable. I talked to Cary and he can add to that later when he has more comments here. Can control that through the rental agreement. Okay, so we have actually taken, to submit this, we are been working on it for about four to five months. We actually went back through DEQ and Cary has hired a sanitarian to work with the county and the DEQ to get the septic system and site evaluations done, because we felt that was as critical as a component as we had to make sure that this fit on the property. And we did get a successful DEQ evaluation for the size of system that we're showing on this site plan there on the west side over by the highway. We want to leave as much as possible in green space as we can, and that's why I'm showing as much landscaping around the area, around the buildings, and even in between the parking areas a little bit, we'll have some landscaping. Cary and I discussed it, and he will be providing a landscape plan when the official plans come in for review by the building department. I think that's probably, and Cary can also add in there, I believe he is planning on a bike rack to go in there, so that should be fine. And I think that's all I have at the moment.
Okay, thank you very much. All right, so we've had testimony from the applicant. Now, Chad, if you can go back to full screen. Thank you. Are there any proponents that would like to speak? If you have something to say positive about this, unmute yourself and speak now.
This is Cary Johnson here. I have something to say.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Cary Johnson. I live at 92080 John Day River Road in Astoria. And I am, I mentioned earlier, I'm a prospective buyer of this property. I've been working with Dale Barrett with this proposal here. And I agree with what Dale has to say on his application. We've discussed it at length. On the parking, we can control those through rental agreements, so we think that we can meet the parking requirements, and that should not be an issue for us. And also with the bike rack, that is also not an issue for us. We will happily add the bike rack to our proposal. But we do have concerns about the drainage and adding all the impervious surface for that roadway, as Dale mentioned. And part of that is cost, and then there is a real issue with the water that the impervious surface would add. So we've seen that a 9x18 space is about a $5,000 cost to a project like this. And when you add the cost of the road, the paving, that's about $162 a square foot for a parking space. And so if we need to pave that entire area there, you can see that that's a significant cost addition. And we're trying to keep costs down to keep rents as low as we can as well. So anyways, that's about all I have to add to it. And I'd be happy to answer any questions if anybody had any for me.
Thank you for your input. Is there anyone else who would like to speak as a proponent of this development?
Madam Chairperson, I should probably give you my address. Sorry,
okay. Yes.
Lost that. Ron Larson, 29101 Southwest Villebois Drive South in Wilsonville, Oregon, 97070.
Ron, would you spell that street? Because we may not be able to...
That is Village in French. That's V-I-L-L-E, B as in boy, O-I-S as in Sam.
Well, okay. does anyone else want to speak as a proponent to this project? Does anyone want to speak opposed to this project?
Excuse me, my name is Carl Johnson. I'm a proponent of this. Sorry, I couldn't get my mute button off.
Would you please, Carl, would you please give us your address?
Okay, our address is 15865 Southeast Van Zyl Drive. Our residential address? Is that what you want?
Yes.
Van Zyl Drive, Damascus, Oregon, 97089.
Okay.
But we own the lot on the other side of Yankee Trader at 4173. And we've had that for a few years and developing that under the right conditions. So we think we can add, we understand also there is a housing shortage for same thing. Permanent housing, local housing, not sort of tourist stuff. And we're interested also in adding to the, more housing. So I think this is a good positive thing for Gearhart developing this.
Okay. And you're driving and in the dark, right?
I'm sitting in my car now. Okay, I didn't want to turn it off because I didn't want to disconnect.
Yeah.
I am kind of in the dark.
Yeah, you look a little creepy there. Okay.
Is that better? That's even more creepy. Sorry. Okay,
thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to speak? I was on to opponents of this, and I don't think I heard anything. Is there anyone who would just like to comment, a neutral comment?
Jenny, is this planning, is this commissioners or is this the
public? No. We're before we get to commissioners. Gotcha. Not to commissioners yet. Did you have something, Carol?
I didn't quite get that. I thought Dan, the last speaker, said he was opposed.
No, he said he was a proponent. He couldn't get himself hooked up.
I got you. Thank you.
Okay. He said he was a proponent because he has property to south, I would assume, of the
Yankee Trader.
It wasn't coming to my head. Okay, so applicant doesn't really have anything to rebuttal. We've heard from everyone. So I am going to close the public hearing. It is now time for the commissioners to ask questions, either Carol or any of the applicants, or just to give your opinion about it. So I'm going to start on my screen here, just calling you because that's easiest. I'm sorry, it's the easiest for me. So Stephanie, do you have anything you would like to share?
Yes, I do. Girard certainly does need some affordable housing for workforce. There's absolutely no doubt of that. And I'm just curious of a ballpark rental figure that they're thinking of, what they're considering affordable.
I'll defer to Carrie. He's the guy.
Are you there?
Carrie, can you unmute yourself?
Sorry, I was trying to get to the unmute button. So I guess the definition of affordable is that could be, who knows what that means anymore.
Exactly.
But typical, we have other units in Gearhart that we feel are similar to this, that rent out for around $1,500, $1,550 a month. It's not, I mean, I guess affordable may not be the accurate description. This is a market rate for this. I mean, depends on what you consider affordable. So in my opinion, that's high. I wish that we could keep the rent down lower. It's very, very difficult to build new affordable housing. So we're trying. I understand it's a major problem, but these are expensive units to build at the same time.
Yeah, I understand that. And my other question would be regarding your rental agreements. Are you looking at leasing or are you looking at month to month?
Typically, we do a 1-year rental agreement. We don't do month to month rental agreements on any of our properties currently.
Good. And one of the last things, there was recently a fourplex in the last couple of years that was built on the west side of the highway down closer to D Street. I don't know if you're aware of those, but it sounds like the appearance of it is very similar to those.
I think I'm aware of the project, but yes, the appearances are similar to that, although I'm not that familiar with that project. It's not related.
Okay. Thank you. If I have any more, you can come back to me, Jenny.
Okay.
Thank you.
David, do you have something you'd like to, questions you have or opinions you'd like to express?
Yes. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay. I have quick questions. Number one, I don't know who I'd adjust this to, but are the units going to be fire sprinkled?
Carrie?
I do not believe we will need to have fire sprinkler systems in that, but that will be a question for the building official. And there's a few different ways we can construct the units with different fire separation walls and different things. So I'm not 100% certain on that as of right now.
Okay, well, my response to you, Carrie, would be that fire sprinklers will lower both your insurance rates and the renter's insurance rates, which would probably pay for that sprinkler system. Number two, sprinklers aren't real expensive these days, so I would recommend you really check that out. The second question or issue I have is the problematic parking thing. I think that stacked parking is going to be inconvenient for a typical person and a typical family, and the residents will be using those left extra parking spaces to help juggle their cars in and out when somebody has to leave earlier or arrive home later. So I'm wondering, is there any way you could talk about 2.5 or 3 spaces at each of those two locations?
Not without making a lot more hard surface, taking out a lot of landscaping, which we're really trying to hope to preserve the way it is. Carrie and I have talked about that quite a little bit, and he does think he can control it through his rental agreements. Being maybe a little more hard line when they come in to rent it, that they are assigned 2 spaces, their garage and the space right behind it, I think we all know that the two extra for visitors are probably going to get used short term by some of the residences, which at least will alleviate some of the issue on stacking. But Carrie has told me he's confident he can control that through his rental agreement.
Okay, thanks for that. The only other comment I had was the issue of how is the best way to control rental units versus condominiums. I mean, is there a time in the future where this project has been worked in and the first year leases are up that they become a private investment?
Well, again, maybe Carrie can answer that, but I think his plan, this is his retirement, correct? we're talking well, about. So you know,
the only warning I can say is that I know the city of Gearhart is not into influencing your business decisions. I was just curious about whether they would become privately owned or stay in a rental pool for a longer period.
Again, Carrie can answer that, but his whole interest in this is to have a long-term investment.
That's correct. This is, I don't have any intention. I have not yet built a condominium to date, and this is my intention to just keep these as an addition to my rental portfolio and rent these out as long-term rental units and maintain ownership as our rental company does.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Johnson. You've done a good job.
Yeah, David, remember, he has to hire local people too. And the entire coast is struggling with finding help unless you get housing for him, you know.
I think I could recommend a good surveyor for him.
Retired surveyor.
Oh. Russ?
Yeah, the only thing I had, Jenny, was, and I do think that we certainly need this project, and it'll be good for the community to have more places for people to possible homes, possible rental homes. But I'm just wondering what's the guarantee that we have if we're in, that we have the two applicants, and then Carrie is going to be the eventual builder. What we approve tonight or in the next month or two. What's the guarantee that becomes what gets built? If a different person is then taking over, is there continuity to what we approve tonight to what gets built a year from now?
I think, Carol, is that a question for you?
Well. I can say that what gets built is will be tied to this plan approval, because the plan will go, you know, when the building permit comes, it goes through planning and we make sure they met all the conditions. Okay. Now, when you're talking about ownership, we don't do that. But you could, I suppose, if you're concerned about the parking, for instance, and the guarantee that the garages be used for a parking space at always. No,
it wasn't that so much, Carol. It wasn't the parking issue. It was just that we have the plan that's on paper, the 135-foot building.
Yeah.
And that will be built, irregardless, it may change the footprint of each individual unit, could change, but essentially that 135 by 42 is what we're saying is okay.
Yeah, and this because it's a conditional use and it requires a special permit, planning, this is the first decision, and the building permit has to comply with the conditions and the plan, design.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. That's good.
Russ, I might add that, you know, we've worked on the due diligence on this for since almost January, February this year, and gotten all the answers that we felt would shoot it down. This is the last one, the conditional use request. And so with that done, we're hoping to move to closing to sell it to Carrie as soon as we can after this meeting, if approved.
Yeah, okay. Thanks.
Okay. Next, Austin, you're next on my screen.
I guess I had a couple questions about the street improvement of Lamont Lane and the Hammerhead section. I guess I'll start with the Hammerhead section. What is really the purpose of the Hammerhead section when it seems like it doesn't really... I guess that was a part of the county partition, and what does it actually serve as purpose of to...
Fire turnaround.
Okay. And Dale had mentioned that this was actually a private easement for Lamont Lane on the property. And so my question, I guess, is to Carol or Chad, how does that fit into our ability to regulate improvements when it's not a dedicated public right of way?
Well, that's a good question. Chad, were you going to speak up? No.
It is a utility easement, so the city has the right to put in utilities within that right-of-way and maintain them.
There, in general, you know, there's many private streets in the world that serve residential units and subdivisions. And it's not exactly a private street, and it's, granted, it's an easement, it's not a tract, but it serves the same purpose as a tract that you'll see on a plat for access. And so it's, you know, should we ask to dedicate to the city this private easement for a city street and start maintaining it?
No.
We didn't think it needed to go that far, but our street standards do require improvements that are serving new development to some street standard. And it doesn't specify or distinguish between public or private. There's no question this is an access easement, and what is on the ground is a road, and that was the purpose. And there will be more development in two directions using this road. And so I believe our code and the subdivision ordinance actually you know, requires compliance with our street standards, which are paid to pave. So you can waive it. There's a waiver if the city manager agrees to that.
So based on what the conclusions, though, that we have to our staff recommendations and the options we have, 3B is to a paved half street improvement on Lamont Lane. Is that correct? With including the half Hammerhead?
Correct. And just, can I stick this in, because it's on my notes here, I forgot about the no parking signs. So that needs to be added to a condition, either separate or to that one, to say to install no parking signs on the north side of Lamont Lane. And I think the applicant was okay with that.
That's correct. We're okay.
That's it.
Okay, thank you, Austin. Next here, Sharon.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I'm just sitting here thinking about the people that are going to be living in these units. And I think that you all have gone to great lengths to talk about the landscaping that you're going to be putting in and preserving, you know, spaces for landscaping. The noise from the highway is going to be almost overwhelming for them. So I would just urge you to put a type of landscaping in that would potentially help mitigate some of that noise. That's all.
Okay, thank you, Sharon. Carrie, you're last on my list.
I have nothing to add.
Okay.
To be last.
All right. I'm sorry. It's just the way it ends up on the screen. For as a side note, last month, Carrie missed her meeting, but he sent me a delightful note. He was feeding a donkey with his granddaughter. Oh. He was not feeding the granddaughter of the donkey. They were together feeding the donkey. So I think that we have this need for more of this kind of parking. There's just not parking, I'm sorry, dwellings. My only concern is back to that street. And I'm thinking that if we have, looking at your plan, that certainly some of these places I would expect would have children, and gravel roads and children, well, they're never a good mix. So I understand the cost of paving, but I also think that, as Carol said, I hate to set the precedent of allowing it not to be paved, because then someone else can come along, and as we get closer into the core of Gearhart, that paving is a real issue. There's still funky little roads in Seaside, one block long, that are still gravel, and they can't get them paved. So that's my only problem, is the paving. So, is there anything that anyone else would like to say more? No? Do I have a motion?
Madam Chair.
Okay, David.
I move that we approve the conditional use permit based on the findings in this report, with conditions of approval as may be modified by the commission.
Okay.
I second Terry.
And Terry seconds it. I want to make sure that I understand your motion, David. You recommend that we approve this with the, including the 3 points, 1, 2, and 3 on pages 18 and 19?
Yes.
Okay, that's what I wanted to clarify. And adding the no parking sign also, correct?
Correct.
All right, thank you. So David has made that motion and Terry has seconded it. Is there any further discussion?
Well, just before you vote, can I make sure you meant 1, 2, and 3, and also below that, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 condition. But there
I only have 1, 2, 3. 4 has been crossed off.
And then, does everybody have prior to issuance of an occupancy permit?
I'm sorry, okay.
Yeah.
I still have 4 that's not crossed off.
Oh, that was Austin in the email that was sent out this afternoon by Carol. I would recommend deleting the highway right-of-way dedication condition 4.
Okay.
Because of the existing, okay?
Yeah, that was my understanding.
Okay, thank you for clarification.
Okay. Okay, I'm sorry, Carol, you're right. Maybe I'm misreading this. We have 1, 2, 3 of prior to issuance of any permits, and then prior to issuance of occupancy permit. Those should also be included, is that
right? Yes, and maybe I'll just renumber them so they are one continuous string of numbers, but
okay.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
All right. Renumbering those.
Yeah.
Okay. And do you want to add no parking signs in there as 9?
I did. I was going to add to number 3B, a new sentence at the end, after detailed street design, install no parking signs on the north side of Lamont Lane.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, I'll repeat the motion as is my understanding, to approve this with the staff recommendations 1, 2, 3 And the new numbering on the second part there, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Correct.
Hey, okay. Any other discussion? Anything else? Dale, I'll let you speak, but you're not really should be by Robert.
Yeah, well, can you clarify on your 3B? It says that you'll have parallel parking spaces on the north side. That's not a part of it, right?
Yeah, I crossed that out in my conversation, but we didn't come back to, let's see.
B, Carol, 3B, a paved half-street improvement on Lamont Lane, including the half hammerhead section, and marked parallel parking spaces on the north side.
Yeah, I crossed it out so much I can't read it.
Want to leave it in there?
That's out. Oh.
Just the parallel parking spaces.
Just the parallel parking and marked parallel parking spaces on the north side. Except
outside the clear vision triangle of the highway. Is that what you want to cross?
No, because that was for the parking tip. So take that whole half of that sentence and mark parallel parking space on the north side, except outside the clear vision area, where there would not have been any parking spaces permitted because that would be unsafe. So 3B is a paved half street. So I'm just going to call it a half street because it just depends on how we lay it out. Improvement on Lamont Lane, including the half hammerhead section, period. Detailed street design specification to be agreed upon by the city and the applicant. Install no parking signs on the north side of Lamont Lane.
South side.
North.
South side.
North.
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 In front of them.
In front of the units?
Yes.
Well, they wouldn't be right there. The only parking you could do is on the rest of the Lamont Lane.
Which would be on the south side.
No, on the west side of the units.
Oh, okay.
Where, you know, the north.
West part, and east.
Wait, I see what you're saying. That's not his north property line. The north side of the street.
Yeah, could we put up the site plan? It would be much easier to point.
No, it's the same as I said. The north side of Lamont Lane. The south side, you know, is still, it's open as gravel, and it's partly there with the Yankee Trader.
You're putting no parking signs in front of the units if you're putting them on the north side of Lamont Lane.
I'm sorry. I would never put them right in front of the units. What is meant by the police chief is on the north side of Lamont Lane, where there are no units.
So
west of the west end
and the highway, between the structure and the highway.
Okay.
I can say that. Right. I think that's a good clarification.
Okay. We had clarity right up to some point here.
Almost missed our chance.
Okay, all right. So I'm going to try one more time here. This is it, we're going for it. Whoa, now Chad's doing something. Chad is pointing out where the no parking signs would be for Austin's for everyone's clarification. And your little cursor is moving around. Did you want to show like where they could possibly put a no parking sign?
Along that little red dashed line is probably gonna have to be on the north side of that line, that sidewalk. No, it's gonna have to be
in the south,
on the south side of that sidewalk, because you don't want to block, right, south side of the sidewalk.
I think it would be on the north side of the sidewalk. You would not want to have any sort of a sign that vehicles would run into. Typically, if you had a sidewalk, you would have the signage on the back side of the sidewalk furthest away from the vehicles.
Good point.
So that would be the north side of the sidewalk.
Okay.
Just to be, I'm not trying to be devil's advocate here, but would we not be concerned about anybody parking along the south side of Lamont Lane along Yankee Trader, that would be impeding any access along that?
Well, just like Ron just said, that end up being in the middle part of the road that's going to be left over here with gravel that's being used by Yankee Trader on his property. I don't think he could put signs in there.
Okay, I guess that's true. I guess if we're paving the 20-foot... Lamont, then...
Yeah, and that's what the police chief said, the north side, so I guess the only place they could go.
Just to meet, that was my thought, was like, if I was to drive in there and go visit somebody, that you and I would park on the south side.
Well, they might, you know.
Yeah, so, but, you know.
Austin, we know that people are very creative in where they park.
Oh, yeah, I know. That's exactly what I was thinking was.
Okay. So we have in front of us a motion to accept the proposal with point one, point two, point three. B is modified with the removal of the parallel parking spaces and addition of the no parking signs, then renumbered from below there to 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, which were previously numbered 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Some of these, of course, go through the planning, through the planning department and other people. So, is there any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Aye, 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 aye. Okay. All those opposed say nay. All right. So we have approved this. I hope that it all works out for you well. And we will move on to the next public hearing.
Thank you very much. Madam Chairman?
Yes. Someone said something.
Are we still in Planning Commission mode, or are we still in the public hearing mode?
We are moving on to the second public hearing.
Correct, because I have a little bit of Planning Commission housekeeping to address before it slips.
Did you want to bring that up under concerns?
I think it's more important than just a concern. This is what I wanted to do was recommend that we offer and approve a belated excused absence for Terry for the last meeting, because he was so stressed out and in the wrong place at the wrong time, and it was not negligence that caused him to miss the last meeting.
Well, I love the note that Terry sent me. Terry, did you want to say something?
Well, what happened is my daughter, who hasn't been here for 8 years, and my granddaughter, who is 8 years old, we picked him up at the airport, I don't know, about 3 or 4 o'clock in Portland, and brought him over here. And the first thing I wanted to do was kind of recreate for our 8-year-old granddaughter what we had done for our other grandchildren. So, you know, we got some carrots and apples and went over to feed Poncho, and it just slipped my mind. I was really embarrassed about it, and I got a text from David the next day wondering where I was. And I actually stayed up here to go to the meeting. So that's what happened. I felt stupid about it, but got to beat Poncho.
Yeah. This would be appropriate to take up after we get done with the public hearing and not in the middle of the public hearing, David. So as soon as we're done with it, yes, Stephanie?
Jenny, could we take a real quick 3-minute break?
Yes, we may take a quick 3-minute break. For those of you that I can imagine, please go need some water or anything else. And those of you that were on for the first part, if you don't want to stay on for any more than, you can leave. You don't have to, you can stay.
Uh, quick question. This is Carl Johnson.
Yes.
What is the second one?
The second one has to do with the Gearhart Master Parks Plan.
Parks and Recreation.
Okay.
So, yeah, City of Gearhart Parks Master Plan. So the nice thing about a Zoom meeting is you can leave when you want to.
And question on the upper left, it says recording. Is there a chance we can get a copy of the recording?
It is recorded. All planning commission meetings have to be recorded. And yes, you will need to talk to Chad about that because I've never actually been involved in it. But yes, I believe that you can, if you can't get a recording, he can certainly arrange for you to listen to it.
Okay, fantastic.
Okay.
And I just want to say hi to Russ. Russ, Carl Johnson, you might not remember, we played golf quite a while ago, Astoria a couple times.
Russ disappeared.
Oh, he did? Okay, I'll talk to him later.
Okay, all right.
Okay, thank you guys.
Sure.
For those who are interested, the score is 0-0, top of the sixth in the Giants-Dodgers game.
Thanks for that.
Okay.
Give me a glass of water. Just water in that pink glass over there. Breathe. Okay.
Just taking a break. Not done.
Just that much. Eight. Mm-hmm. 10 ounces.
We're out of training. We're not used to these long meetings.
I know. Okay, Russ, come back. Come back, Russ. Oh, there's Russ. He's back. David, are you there? David,
coming.
Okay, I can't tell if you're there or not because remember, you're just a black square.
I heard my name.
Okay, just wanted to make sure you're back. And is Chad here, I assume. Chad, are you there?
Yes, Madam President, I am.
Did you hear the question by Carl Monique's phone about listening or getting a recording of the meeting?
I did, and you answered it correctly.
Okay. I made that up.
It was good.
Okay. All right, so we're all back. And Sharon and Terry, you're here with us?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes, I'm here.
Terry's watching the game. Okay, so the next thing we have on the agenda is 21-04CP.ZTA Gearhart Parks and Recreation Master Plan. Carol, would you like to speak?
Yes, ma'am. I think I'd like to start with just making sure everybody has the right documents. So there's a staff report. There's a draft master plan, the latest draft out of the committee of October 2nd. The parks and open space zone that's extracted from the zoning code.
Okay.
And the three big pages that we used at the work session, number one, proposed park plan policies, number two, and proposed additions, deletions, or corrections to this plan. The city finds the amendments are important to the residents and visitors of the Gearhart community, finding the amendments are in compliance with the relevant policies of the Gearhart Comprehensive Plan, and that there is a need to include community parks and recreation policies and guidelines in its planning process and development regulations. So that the reason we're doing this is because we have the primary reason is we have a comprehensive plan policies that says we shall develop a parks master plan, which I think was adopted in 1974. So we're finally here. And so this, of course, is consistent with that policy. The amendments are also consistent with the transportation system plan. And that's why we need some of the maps from there to go in here. The absence of the plan at this point eliminates the opportunity to plan further for future Gearhart residents and visitors and land development to be sure and incorporate these facilities. Prior land use decisions affecting city parks and open spaces have occurred without the foresight of specific policies and guidelines relevant to city parks. The plan provides the ability for the city to consider if new development is consistent with relevant park plan policies, has access to parks, and whether on-site park improvements to new development may be applicable. City of Gearhart does not have adequate funding to maintain and develop park and recreation improvements, so that adoption of the plan establishes a premise for the city to request state or federal funding for city park improvements, like playground equipment. For these reasons, the Oregon Parks and Rec Department awarded the city a $15,000 grant to develop this park's master plan with policies and standards for Gearhart. The grant was awarded in October of 2019, so for the past 2 years, the city officials have devoted significant time and resources to develop the plan. The plan grant is paid for costs incurred primarily by the city planner in the development, preparation, publication of the plan. The grant will fund plan graphics, photos, and publication once we get through the policy reviews in the near future. And then the deadline was actually October 31st to finish all this, but we have a request in and a pretty much verbal guarantee that we'll get an extension until March 1st. So before I say any more, the authors of this plan really put in a huge amount of volunteer time and effort to create the plan. And many, many thanks to George for taking the lead on this, because I mean, I've never seen such citizen commitment to the time and the thinking and the organization and all the writing that he put into this over the last year and a half. And same with Austin, Tomlinson, who did a lot, almost all the work on the survey work and the aerial photo in there that shows where all the surveys come, and he compiled the surveys and he summarized what the results were. And that was just a lot of work as well. They had 14 meetings with the advisory committee. It was just like clockwork every month. They stayed on task thanks to the leadership of George and his ability to continue to pump out drafts of this thing along the way. So this is the point now where we need to integrate it into the rest of our planning system and adopt it soon and begin to use it as a legal document and also a great guide for all aspects of our park planning. One of the things I want to bring up that I mentioned earlier tonight, specifically right now, is just to make sure that everyone's aware, because it's not really quite in here yet. In the zoning ordinance amendments on page 3 of the staff report, the proposed plan needs to be cross-referenced to the park and open space zone, section 3.9, as well as the subdivision ordinance to implement the policies established by the plan itself. There are proposed policies that may be listed as uses or limitations in the zoning ordinance, such as the park bench policy, because that bench policy has been floating around for, I don't know, at least 20 years, and nobody knows who's in charge of it or what exactly it says and how to implement it. So I propose we put it right in the zone so that the next time, so that there is a place to find those answers. Do we have a limit on park benches? What are they supposed to look like? And so I propose we stick it in the park zone, nothing much else in that park zone. And if there's going to be things placed in our city parks, it's likely to be a bench to start with, especially in the dunes. And then that's the beaches and dunes overlay zone out there, that where the city park zoning is. And hopefully Chad is here still, who can put a map up. Let's see, how did we decide to do this? That at least shows the Little Beach Park Zone. I don't know if he did GIS or, yeah.
Yeah, Carol, I'll pull it up by GIS.
Yeah, okay. Because we also have on our goals list, and in the zoning, applicable to the zoning, the park zone, are environmental integrity issues. Primarily what we've been talking about kind of off and on for some time is the riparian vegetation protections in the Mechanicum Estuary that, thank you, you see the green is park land, city park, and it goes from the Big Beach to Little Beach, and it stops at Hager in front of the Wiederhorn property. And so this does not affect any private land. This is just the city park land, that green, where we're recommending, I'm recommending, that you add the riparian protection vegetation thing. That we already have in place for the Mechanicum River and the Mill Creek, and the Neocoxy Creek, as it's stated in the comprehensive plan. And just a minute here, I'm lost in my own work. I guess I can come back to that, but so here it is. The plan, the comprehensive plan states that riparian vegetation shall be maintained and where appropriate restored consistent with the provision of water dependent uses, and the city will implement a program to maintain a 50-foot riparian zone of the Mechanicum Estuary. So that's in the comprehensive plan, but it never made it into the zoning code that I've been able to find. Commissioner Klopfer brought it up at one point, and we added it to the goals list and decided the best time to, maybe the best time, maybe this isn't the best, but at least it seemed convenient to address this now in the park and open space zone, to put that provision in the park and open space zone, like it's in some other zones. So that's one specific thing I wanted to point out. Let's see what else.
Can I ask a question while Carol's there?
Yeah.
Carol, when I read that, the setback shall be measured from the mean high water line.
And there's always been a great discussion of exactly where is the mean high water line. And there's no map showing us this, and there's no, we don't have any data of how that was determined. I have some real questions about that wording.
Yeah, and you know, interestingly, I mean, that's a good point. This came up with this Little Beach Lodge a couple weeks ago, because they want to do some riprap repair and improvements in front of their lodge. And so city planner and ex-mayor of Cannon Beach, Mike Morgan, and I walked around there to figure out both what the lodge wants to do and what that mean high water mark means. And we called Tom Horning, who defined it. And honestly, I don't have that formula right in front of me tonight. But it's measurable.
It is measurable. And I think the Department of State Lands of Oregon really determines that.
I think you're right. That's right. That was and another.
How do we know exactly where it is so people know how to measure from that line? There's no map. There's no information in any of our
Yeah, that's a good question. I think, stay there, Austin. I think it has to be site specific. You agree?
That's true. Yeah, it's got to be delineated by the Department of State Lands, and they own everything below that line, so they have this. They have that line established at some point.
And that was the only way. The only way we could get. Jeffrey Strange, his answer, and it was like an 8-foot mark on his property, which would require a review for him.
You mean the 50 feet? You were talking about the 50 feet.
Well, yeah, and he wants to riprap, and the question is, can he riprap where it is?
Yeah, he wants to repair and maintain what he has.
Yeah. And, you know, he didn't ever have to in the past because there wasn't any oversight of this or, it didn't make it to the zoning code. It's in the plan, but it's not in the zoning code. But that's another reason it needs to be in there. But regardless, I don't know. I can't tell you all the answers right now because it's still to be determined. But I've been directed to go to Crest and talk to Denise. And what does this email say? I just got today to figure that out for him. But the same is true. The point is, maybe Chad knows more. It's site specific, and it is determinable, right? But the 50 foot. Now let's go back to what we're talking about, and that is back to the park zone. And somebody tell me where it is in my staff report. Where's the wording? Well, here it is. All in the Canicum River estuary setback. All structures and uses shall be set back 50 feet from the Canicum River estuary unless direct water access is required in conjunction with a water-dependent use. The setback shall be measured from the mean high water line. Riparian vegetation within this setback shall be protected as specified in EGO section 6.0705. And I'll grab that, but meantime, let me make it clear again that I think that should go in the P-zone, at least in the location where it's affected by the Nicanicum estuary. And I'm going to stop on that subject for a minute to see if there's anything else to point out. The only other thing that keeps coming up is mowing the beach grass. And what can we do in our own park zone that the city is responsible for, not necessarily for private properties, to deal with that issue? Because there's two sides to it. One is that kind of industrial level machine cutting device that goes out and knocks it all down is also keeping the scotch broom out and the blackberries and other things. We know a lot of property owners do it up in the Palisades and the Highlands for their views. And Oregon State Parks has not been, I don't think they've been enforcing their permitting for that over the years. So it's been something that's always just been done. And the question is it the right thing to do or not? But it, I think if we could at least start with our own zone, park zone to figure that out and not necessarily apply it anywhere else yet.
Well, Carol, you talk about the mowing. I thought a couple of years ago we talked about you can't cut something more than 50%. Isn't there something established about mowing the grass out in front of homes that's already on the books? Or is this something different?
Yes, and Chad, I'm calling you the enforcer of this, which goes out and trumps around all over the place all the time to answer that question.
Thank you, Carol. Essentially, it was the removal of noxious weeds. It has to do mostly with the mowing. In order to remove noxious weeds in the findings, in the vegetation discussion and the ordinance, Kathleen Sace, a biologist, mentioned that the best way to remove weeds, noxious weeds, from the area is to mow the beach grasses down, right down to the sand, because in her view, the beach grasses would come back more quickly than the weeds would. And we're starting to see some evidence of that. I think I pulled up a picture here between what it used to look like with all the scotch broom in this area as it was filled in when we had people walking on. And then we look at Google Earth now, the way that it is. It doesn't quite look like that anymore. The grasses are coming back in, as well as some of the scotch broom, of course. This is going to be something that we're going to have to keep on top of over the years, but it was mostly based in noxious weed removal.
Yeah, it looks really good, Chad. I've been really impressed with how that's actually worked out.
So, that aside for the moment, we're here really to talk about the plan in total, and, well, I guess more than that, not just to talk about it yet, but to have a public hearing and see if we have any public input on the draft. And then dive into to your recommendations and comments and objections and so on.
Okay, thank you, Carol. So would it be appropriate to have the applicant speak now, Carol? Or is the city the applicant and there isn't really an applicant?
City's the applicant, legislative amendment. I just gave you a brief staff report. It complies with our plan. We're really talking about the details now and the plan itself and what else you might like to see. So I would open it up to the public right now and see anybody has comments.
All right, so it's time for comments from the public. We first take the proponents. So if there's someone that would like to speak in support of the plan, please unmute yourself and I will try to recognize you. Michael Hoare, you've unmuted yourself. Did you have something to say?
Yeah, I just wanted to ask a question. I was looking on the website and it said,
Before you give your testimony,
I'm sorry.
Would you mind putting your name and address, please, for us for the record?
Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah, my name is Michael Hoard, H-O-A-R-D, and I'm at 13095 Princeton Court, Lake Oswego, Oregon 97035.
Okay.
And so my question is, on the website, they said that there would be maps showing beach access and other trail locations and things like that. So I was wondering when the timeline, when that will be made available, and is it going to be made available in a draft form and we could review and then provide comments at that time, or what's the process that we would be able to see some of that coming forward?
Yeah, we don't have the graphics in this document yet. And you're right, I wish we did. We do have, the transportation plan has a full listing of trails and sidewalks all over the urban growth boundary that will be part of this, because of course some of those overlap with the beach trails. And then what the plan is, since we have some graphics budgeted in this to both print it and finalize it, is to create a trail map. And it's off to a slow start because I started with one angle with an architect to help me draw it, and now we're working with the GIS, Mark Scott, our GIS person, to get him to get them on the GIS, because that's commonly where people will look for transportation routes and trails and so on. And then also have a paper version that's in this document that, you know, we can hand out, or it could become just a trail guide. So that's in the works, and it's just not there yet.
Sure. Yeah, and I'm hoping that we'll have a chance to review that in a draft form before that it's decided, you know, that that's the official document. And my hope is also that that it would reflect the current conditions of where, like, routes are, where people are normally going, and that would be in the spirit of keeping things, you know, for the most part, the way they are now, instead of a new kind of direction. So,
well, have you had a chance to look at the Parks Master Plan?
Yes.
And have you seen them all listed there?
Yes.
So they are there, and they're all documented in the plan.
Yes.
It's just that, like you said, we need to have it graphically as well. Is that what you're saying?
And I'm hoping to be part of that review, and I look forward to seeing that. So,
will you help me?
Sure, yeah, if you want.
Well, you live in Lake Oswego, but you come to Gearhart.
Yeah, we've been here for five generations, so yeah, we're regular. We come here a lot. So, yeah.
I'm kind of kidding, but not really, totally.
No, I'm happy to help, so thank you. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, Michael. Moving on, is there anyone else that would like to speak? You need to unmute yourself so I can tell that you would like to speak. Mike, there's a mic. Mike, if you would identify yourself, your full name and your address, please.
Mike Cranston, 5130 Southwest Windsor Court, Portland, 97221. And we've got a house in Gearhart. So I just wanted to, I've read the plan. I think the committee did a great job. It was intensive. I appreciate the way it was written. It was written collaboratively. And it recognized also the spirit of it was that there's competitive interest in all the park areas. So I thought it was well done.
Okay. Thank you. I grew up on Windsor Court, so that was a long time ago.
Where?
In Portland?
No, I know. Where in Windsor Court?
Right off of Shattuck?
Yeah.
The first house?
Yeah, sure. That house is sold. I'm on the same side of the street, the second to last house.
It was built when I was in eighth grade, so it was a long time ago. Okay.
Whole world.
No kidding.
Okay. Anyone else that would like to speak? Unmute yourself and then I can tell you want to speak. I'm not seeing anything. Opponents, this is the time if you're not, if you have concerns or questions, not questions, but you're opposed to parts of it or anything like that. So unmute yourself. I am not seeing anything, and I don't think Chad is seeing anything. Chad has a better view than I do. Anyone that just like to make a comment and isn't either for or against? I'm not.
Will there be more public hearings? I'm not familiar with the process, so.
Okay. We'll see where we get to today, Michael. This is the first time that the Planning Commission has looked at it. Is that correct, Carol?
I would correct you. You had a work session and looked at the plan in August 31st. And
okay.
So it's not the first time you've seen it, but this draft has gone public. And with the extension, there is another round of hearings that goes through the council, of course, after the Planning Commission makes a recommendation. So we're coming into the holiday season, so I don't know exactly how this will go, but hopefully we'll have it adopted by March 1st, and more hearings and testimony and opportunities to comment and finish it between now and then.
Okay, great, thank you.
Okay, you're welcome. All right, so having no more comments tonight, I'm going to close the public hearing, right, Carol?
Uh-huh.
All right, so now is the time for commissioners to discuss, ask questions. I'm gonna start with Terry. I'm gonna go backwards.
Well, thank you. I think they did a tremendous job. I've been through the whole thing. And I like the fact that they do recognize that there are some competing interests in the town, but I think that they have come up with good solutions to those competing interests. With all the work and volunteerism that went into this, I really can't find anything that I object to.
Okay, thank you, Terry. I think I maybe blew that, Carol, because you said you'd want me to go through the big sheet.
I don't know if you want to or not. If you felt like digging down into the details.
Okay. Before we go on, Carol, I was concerned that number 16 on that list is no place listed in the policy, but yet it seems to have appeared there.
Wait, what page one?
My big page. Number 16, environmental integrity maintained in public parks. I don't see that.
You don't have that on yours?
Well, my policies don't have that.
Oh, well, to develop a new policy, it says.
Okay. So it's just not included in
this
the
came up in the work. I'm sorry, I have to keep interrupting. In the work session, it was raised by Sharon, and as a new policy.
Okay.
And so I transferred it through her.
But we don't have that policy.
Well, you're right. It says develop a new policy and define, but. It's not there yet, and then that because it needs discuss. I mean, I don't know that we've thoroughly fleshed it out.
Okay.
Other than just adding it as a suggestion in the work session, and then the other one was the benches in dunes along the estuary and other park properties. So I just added those two as a result of the work session to figure out what to do with them.
Okay, and then you don't list long-term goals. Policy number 17 and policy 18, park facilities to be incorporated into future development, is blank. Right?
I wouldn't be surprised if I missed a lot of things. the way this all came out last week was like a marathon. So thank you. I might have missed it. What did you say again? 18 was the...
Okay, you have, I'm in the policy that as presented to us in the plan, you have number 17 on page 42 as long-term goals. That is not listed on the proposed park plan policy big sheet. And number 18, park facilities to be incorporated into future developments, it's a blank page in the draft form, and it is not on the big sheet. I'm just fine to know, do we ignore those?
Yeah, you do just what you're doing and tell me what I missed.
Carol, I don't know if it would be appropriate for me to comment, but I might be able to help straighten out a little confusion.
Is that George?
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, there you are. Yes, please.
After the work session, various people took notes. Carol took some notes. I think Chad took some notes. The mayor took some notes. I took some notes. And there, one of the other commissioners also supplied written comments. And I did my best to try to capture the input that was received from members of council and members of the planning commission, and made a number of changes to the draft that everybody reviewed at that work session. And then the draft that you have before you tonight reflects all of those changes. But at the same time, Carol was updating the chart you're looking at here, which was an effort to sort of summarize the more complete plan document. My view is that it would probably be more productive for the commission to be focused on the plan document itself rather than the summary. I think the summary was really more for the work session to sort of guide the initial discussion. And I don't see this as the controlling document, but the plan itself is the document that I think is before you to be adopted. But if you see things that are on these notes that you think are, that give you ideas about changes you'd like to make to the plan, that certainly is appropriate for the Planning Commission to discuss at this point. But I don't think this document that's up on the screen now is the plan that's under proposal. No. It's more of a set of notes kind of at one point trying to distill what's in the plan. But I think the plan has kind of moved beyond this document now.
Yeah, you're right, thank you. I admit that I didn't have the time to go back to yours and figure out how that looked different than this. So maybe the advice is better to just, at least for the number one, is to not use those policies and go stick with the plan. And then state number two, there's really nothing we have to do because it's just the beginning of a capital improvement plan that is required, I think, for a master plan. But that number three might be something that we, and George, I don't know if you have any input on that one or your document does. Future parks.
I could make a couple other comments that hopefully would be
helpful. I think we need to move on with the Planning Commission. This is Russ.
Russ, thank you. I was trying to clarify, Russ. Carol has given me advice on how to do it. I hear what's going on. Carol, is that okay with you if we just move on with the planning commissioners discussing this? Is that okay?
Yeah, if you're not, forgive me for the confusion on the chart.
Okay, so Russ, good point. Carol's confusing me. It was my fault, okay? So Terry, did you have anything else you'd like to say?
No, I don't.
Okay, Sharon, would you like to chime in?
Yes, I would. Thank you, Jenny.
Okay.
I'm hearing George say that he incorporated a lot of the suggestions that were brought in the work session. And there's some things that I'm not seeing. Number one being the estuary riparian zone. I don't see that in this second draft. Also, several people in the work session, including counselors and myself, objected to the preservation of ocean views wording. And the copy of the second draft that I have, that has not been changed or modified in any way that I can see. And then thirdly, when I brought up the idea of environmental integrity, which Carol put as number 16, but is not in any of the policies at this point, obviously didn't get put into the policies. Nothing along those lines really got put into the policies. I'd like to see that put as a policy. I would like to have tree and vegetation maintenance and protections under that heading, and I would like to see pesticide use addressed under that heading as well. Thank you.
Thank you for your comment, Sharon. Moving through here, Austin, I know that you worked on this draft, so this is probably dear to your heart.
Yeah, it was, we've had a, well, I guess I didn't know it was 14 sessions to go through this. There was just a few comments I had on, I guess the comments that we had during the work session. I think this reflects a little bit about what Sharon said about the Leslie Miller do the number 5 policy, delete plot primarily and broaden ocean to scenic open views. I think we had discussed this at some length with throughout the process about ocean views being a obviously a viewpoint of many residents. So I thought that a compromise was the scenic and open views, language being the compromise there. So wherever that is inserted, I feel like that's a good compromise.
B4C, policy 4 under C.
Policy number 5, I think that was a Leslie Miller. I think that was just in that draft policy, big page that Carol provided. But I think that should be reflective throughout the whole document if that's the case. The other thing was to add a map of the park and open space zoning. I know that the maps and the visuals are not yet completed, but I think that would be a good addition to the document. The other thing I just recently noticed, and we had discussed this at some point during the Parks Commission meeting, was there's a forested area above Thompson Falls that the city of Gearhart actually owns. And I know that we had talked about only including property within the city limits, but we'd also have a section within the document that's publicly owned properties relevant to parks planning. I think that forested area above Thompson Falls would be a great addition to that area of the document.
Where now? Where do you want to put it in the document?
It would be page 15. I guess it would be section 4B, other publicly owned properties relevant to parks planning.
Thank you.
The only other comments I had were the appendix. Appendix 2, which is funding information. I think there's some outdated information, or not outdated, but like Bureau of Land Management is not somebody who's really going to be working in our area.
Good. Wait, let me find that. This is appendix 2 on page 54.
Yes.
But
this is just, minor details with,
Oh, that's good, because these, these lists get passed around.
Yeah.
Over time.
BLM, as their closest property is down by Tillamook, they have a bunch of checkerboard pieces down there. But
thank you. That's good. That's good input.
But National Park Service, they, the Lewis and Clark system is adjacent to us here, especially up at Sunset Beach. So that would be a good partnership. Even the Forest Service, we don't have any property really close to our area, but they do have provide some funding opportunities. I know they've done some work with the Arch Cape Watershed District with some of their watershed planning. NOAA and the National Marine Fisheries Department, they would also be a good partner, especially with the estuary and our fisheries offshore of Gearhart. Page 55, some of the nonprofit organizations. North Coast Watershed Council, although they are a nonprofit organization that works within our region, the Nakanikum Watershed Council is really the overarching group that would be included in Gearhart. Then I know we had mentioned North Coast Land Conservancy and some of their areas of the plan, but I think they would be good to be included in there.
Yep.
And despite our cross organizations, but my organization I work for, Columbia Land Trust, we do work in this area. We've actually recently just purchased a conservation easement just east of Gearhart with working with North Coast Land Conservancy. So we would be some partner at some point. Columbia Land Trust.
Land Trust. Thank you. Any addresses appreciated, by the way, in the future?
Yeah, I'll sell some of those addresses. Oregon Department of Forestry, also one of the other ones. I didn't see that included in here.
I'm pretty sure you're the only person that's paying attention to this section.
I did see, Oregon Department of State Lands. For some reason, the funding information, it was stated that the wetland mitigation banking was part of that. I think just it was mentioned twice in the appendix.
Is that wrong?
What?
Is that wrong? Oregon Department of State Lands on page 63?
Well, you have it on 54 as Department of State Lands wetland mitigation banking, and you also have it on 63.
Oh.
Oregon Department of State Lands.
Oh, I didn't.
Their easement program, I guess. It's all one department, so I think you could probably narrow it down just the department.
Okay, good. I'll take out the one on 54.
Yeah. Oregon Parks and Restoration. I guess, well, you had We're going to put on Fish and Wildlife.
It's page 55.
ODOT, State Lands, DEQ, OLEB, Oregon Parks and Recreation Department. Okay. Yeah, just make sure you got all the state agencies.
Great. Thank you.
I think that's it.
Well, that's why you're an expert at this office, because others of us would not have known that. So thank you. Russ, I know you want to say something. Go ahead, Russ.
You asked Russ?
Russ, yes. Mr. Taggart.
Oh, yes. Well, okay, what I need a little more clarification about where this fits in the Gearhart documentation department. Because earlier on, we talked about this being relative to LCDC Goal 8, and where we have one of the eight items on there is about a parks and recreation. So we're meeting that with everything we're talking about tonight. But where does this fit in our, has it become part of the comprehensive plan? Does it become an addendum? Does it become a separate segment within our paperwork trail, or where do we fit this?
It's just like the transportation system plan. It's a separate document, but it's a supplement to the comprehensive plan, which was written so long ago. To bring the comprehensive plan up to date, where we said we needed a parks plan, and here it is. So when the council adopts this, they're also adopting it as an cross-reference to the comprehensive, as a part of the comprehensive plan. It's a part of it, is what it is, just like the transportation plan is. And so to use it that way, you know, like tonight when we talked about the trails and the roads for that new development, the details, we go to the transportation system plan to find out how it affects that property. And we will be able to do the same thing when a new development comes in our planning world by looking at our parks master plan and seeing if there's a proposed park near this new development, or there's a connection that needs to be made with the trail, or so on. I mean, it's just a back and forth working and these integrated documents, even though they're separately printed.
I got you. Okay, well, and then just my comment overall.
You need chocolate, you need caffeine.
A lot of time on several things, but one of our call-in people
had a
question about maps,
yeah.
Which I didn't know that was part of something we were going to present, but I suggest that we still have work to do. I'd like to see this come to us with the maps so that the public can see the whole document and, you know, make references to the, you know, to the Miller Park and the Ridge Path and the estuary and all these different areas, which 99% of us know what we're speaking about. But I mean, if we say we're going to have maps, we should have them. If we're not going to include maps, let's not have them. So that's my comment.
No, I totally agree with you. We came up against the deadline for the grant. The plan wasn't finished in that regard. And there has to be maps in a plan, otherwise nobody will read it. But you know what I mean? I mean, there has to be identification on maps of all these parks. So we are working on that within our extension that we expect to get. So, you know, we had this set for a hearing to meet the original deadline, and we went ahead with the hearing, although we postponed it 1 month. We don't have all the pieces together. I'm pretty sure I did send you the one parks map plan. It was a separate email. It had both the TSP trails and bike routes that are a complement to this plan, and it also had a map of our existing parks on an aerial, just named. So, you know, that's the beginning of our graphics that are yet to be done.
But, you know, and I did see that, and I think that's appropriate. But personally, I would like to see maps of identifying the parks. I think it's too comprehensive if you have the maps that show, you know, potential trails and bike paths and walking paths and all that stuff that are on the highway. And maybe I'm not looking at this properly. I don't, you know, I can stand corrected, but I think the public would like to see maps to get to the beach, maps to get to Little Beach, maps to find the ridge path, that kind of stuff. Yeah. That's, most of the public thinks of those things as the parks, not something out on the highway.
But, you know, or a future park. You know, the highway issues are really the connections to the beach or a pond or the ridge path. And it's the connections that the transportation plan is trying to plan for so that those things link up. But the plan itself, the paper plan, has a list of all the beach trails, all the trails to the beach. And, you know, I think the committee agreed the best thing to do would be to get those on a map that you could fold up and hand out, or at least have in this document. And that is the plan, to get all those beach trails on a map. And some pictures of the ridge path in here. And, you know, the beaches and dunes down at the south end of the estuary and so on, to make this make it more complete.
All right. Thank you.
Okay, Russ, thank you. David? Hello, David.
Yes. It's really hard for me to expand on anything that I've heard so far. All I have is a huge appreciation for Austin and anybody else who worked on this, and the city for all their efforts, as stretched and challenged as they have been for the past year. So I have no other comments than just a huge appreciation.
Okay, thank you, David. Stephanie.
Yeah, I have one concern and actually kind of one comment. Sharon mentioned that she didn't see anything about the Mechanicum Estuary and the riparian. And in your staff report on page 7 and 8, the provision reads as follows. Exactly where would that go? Where does that fit in here?
It would go into the park zone that is this other section of a code, zoning code. Parks and open space zone, section 3.9.
So this piece?
Yeah, this little two-pager. Is that what that is?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, and if we're going to do that, and you're still going to talk about, if you're still going to talk about my water line, I would like to see at least a formula or a means to figure that out included.
Yeah, so would I. Okay, well, we'll see what we can come up with.
But answering Sharon's question, you have written something regarding that.
Yeah, I think she might have seen that, and I don't know. But she didn't see.
She didn't see the actual parks plan.
She didn't see it in the parks plan, yeah. And any policy about it. She didn't see a policy in the parks plan.
Right.
And I was trying to get at least to figure out how we would implement it, which would be in the zone. But that needs to be in there. So if it probably needs to be tied to an environmental integrity policy of some kind, and that would be an example of how we would be implementing it, putting it in this zone. But if Sharon wants to talk to me about how to develop that on the side, that'd be great.
Okay, and you'll try to figure that out for us?
I don't know how Tom Horney's going to put this in writing for us to figure out how to measure the high water mark, but I'll come back with an update.
Thank you.
Thank,
I think you need to talk to Dan Carey at Department of State Lands.
Okay, you need to tell me how to reach those people, Austin. Your resources are endless.
Okay, I'll email.
Thank you.
Okay. Once we get that line, we can actually put it on the GIS as an established line, and that would help us locate that setback.
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. That's what I was asking to see, and Austin kept saying that it's site specific, that there isn't really a line. It depends.
It's just interpretation of the state, I think, but as far as what their data sort of tells them.
I'd like to see a map.
What's that?
I'd like to see it on a map.
Yeah, I know.
I feel like everybody else that everybody's done an amazing job and that a lot of work has been put into this, but that it's not finished. And I personally don't feel in a place to adopt this or move on with it. I think we still need to look at it.
Can I just make one more comment? I just realized I had a note on, I guess it's the number 3 proposed future parks and trails draft. We had talked about multiple times about Necoxy access to the creek, specifically for any water access. And one of the things I thought about later on was the bridge and the culvert at G Street. Mm-hmm. Because one of the possible proposed areas of access would be right there at the corner of their GC and the Necoxy. And so I think that culvert and the overall title exchange process of there is undersized, I think. I know Chad has probably heard about this and with the Watershed Council too, but I think if we do have any Necoxy access adjacent to that area, it would be beneficial to have some type of open access to the estuary. So if we did decide to replace that culvert along with any transportation plan designs, that would be great to have it be open for water access.
The water access there is, I've kayaked there numerous times. The water access there is really tidal dependent.
Yeah. But I think it doesn't just go just to public access, it also has to go to fish access with that culvert. Mm-hmm. I know the Watershed Council has that on its list as potential, fixes within the watershed. So whatever we can do to promote any water access, not only for fish, but recreation as well, would be great.
Are you talking about the city-owned parcel there on the north side of the street at G where?
Yep.
Yeah, there's a nice little bit of land that's actually walkable.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty sure it's in the master plan.
Yeah, I think it is. But the culvert itself, as far as on G, is not really a part of that plan for the access. The water access. So I think if we would want to least include that concept into any future transportation improvements to that culvert or Long G.
Got it.
Hey, Stephanie, anything else?
No, not now.
It's my turn. When we had the meeting August 31st, I kind of kept my mouth shut. I know that's strange, but I did because I wanted to hear what the public had to say. Not hearing a lot from the public, so I do appreciate the comments we got tonight. I had some concerns. One, I think a lot of this stuff in this plan should be in appendices. All of the people's opinions. A lot of this, Because when you're looking for policies in a developer or a homeowner or whatever it is, they do not want to thumb through multiple pages of comments that were made, the bios of the committee. I mean, there is a huge amount of work, but I think a lot of this can be moved back to appendices so that we have the meat there right at the beginning. That being said, Carol, the park in the reserve is not owned by Gearhart Holdings LLC. It is owned by the reserve, the reserve at Gearhart HOA. That company no longer even exists.
It's called the Reserve at Gearhart HOA.
The same entity that runs the it's managed by, it's owned and managed by us. There's my little square foot in there someplace. There's grammar errors, and grammar errors bug me because I start reading it and I get hung up on them. I have real problems with the idea of having a Gearhart Parks Commission that has a budget, that has the ability to go out and spend money, that has the ability to contract with other people to have work done, that has the ability to get other funding resources, like through publicly issued bonds. That is something that is done through the city, and I have real problems giving any commission that ability. But Gearhart is a small community. We have small parks. The big park the state of Oregon owns, and I was totally blown away with that idea. We don't need, in my opinion, this commission. And within that information, for instance, in policy number 14, where it talks about make use of the city's park facilities for tournaments, entertainment. Our comprehensive plan says that we're not going to try to promote tourism, and yet that's exactly what that would do. City of Seaside does tournaments to get heads in beds, tourism.
Wait, what page are you on?
I'm on the bottom of page 39 in policy number 14.
Thank you. You're going fast, and I'm trying to keep up.
That's the way I live, Carol. What I'm really saying is I think this idea of the Parks Commission or a Parks Committee, I have no problem with that, having some oversight and making suggestions and that. But when you get into having a budget and being able to go get other funds, I have problems with that. I had problems with them saying it would be less expensive to get private contractors to take care of our parks. I don't know what the basis is for that. And like I said, policy number 18 is blank. And I've talked to you about this, Carol, and I'll reiterate it again. Even though I heard Russ say 99% of us know where everything is, well, the map does not include my neighborhood.
Yes.
It's not a good map. It doesn't include all of it. We need to see where these parks are. We need to have them identified for myself. I want to know where all those access points are, because that's part of what we're approving here. Mm-hmm. The other part is that I've said this, I'm much more familiar with the part of Gearhart to the north than I am to the south. And I know we have verbal descriptions of where things are, but I'm not absolutely 100% sure they're accurate. There's parts of public stuff that are kind of tucked away here and there. So I just need to see more. And I understand your deadline, but I think we'd be doing a disservice to the city of Gearhart to approve something that isn't complete at this point. I understand the draft, but I also would like to see that there aren't blank pages. There's more maps. There's pictures of what a good park looks like, or what we have now, what we want to maintain. And that's what I have to say.
Thank you, and I want you to know I never intended for this to go past you tonight. I never thought it could or would. It's the beginning of the public comment, of which there hasn't been very much.
So what do we want to do now? I need to hear.
I move we put it on hold for until Carol brings us another version.
Do you want to keep the hearing open? Do we do it that way? Or not?
I have a motion.
I second the motion.
I can't. We can.
David seconds the motion.
David seconds the motion. Ross is saying motion. David has seconded to postpone this until it is complete. Is that what you said, Russ? Do I have that correct?
I said, let's postpone it until we see further revisions to what we see in front of us today.
Okay. We've got through that part. Now we can have discussion. Carol has mentioned we could continue the public hearing.
Which what does that entail?
Another option.
All it entails is just saying it in the motion, and we'll just keep it open.
So people can put any comment in for the next our next meeting?
I think we would be open to that and welcome it.
Okay, I would agree to that.
It would be really nice if somehow we could get past COVID and we could have some kind of a town hall.
I know.
The maps could actually be there and people could actually see hands-on things and talk about it. But that's pie in the sky, I know.
Okay. So we have a motion that is not to continue the public hearing. So let me say that we can vote down Russ's motion.
Let's
have a different motion. And I'm just trying to keep it
Okay. Let Russ redo his motion to reiterate Carol's suggestion that we keep the hearing open.
Let Russ, why don't we vote on your motion? We'll be official, we'll be above board, and then we'll have a second motion, okay? If this doesn't pass, okay?
Fine. No.
All right. So I'm going to take a vote now. Hey, all those in favor of Russ's motion, say aye.
Would you word it again before we vote?
Russ, would you please
word it? I say no.
Don't vote, Steph.
He did not propose keeping the public hearing open. He proposed delaying it till we have more information.
You have no positive votes for that. Let's move on.
Okay. We have, all right, all those opposed to Russ's whatever it was.
Aye.
Okay.
No. I actually like it.
Okay. So let's have a different motion, Russ.
I move that we keep the hearing open so we can have further input to it until we talk about it again.
We have to do it to a date certain. Is that right, Carol?
Yes.
Well, yeah, I guess we should try and hit that right. If it doesn't happen, we can always continue it again. But when would you like to, now November, this gets too complicated, but we don't have a date in November for a regular meeting because that's a Veterans Day. The question is, when can it all be ready for you? Is that maybe a better question?
Yeah.
Christmas Day.
No, January.
Well, then
January 2022.
Yeah, might take
first
that long.
First planning commission in January.
Okay, the first meeting in January is the 13th.
That's a lucky day.
Or the 9th in December.
I think that's too soon myself. Apologies.
Well, it's up to staff,
okay, I think. Up to Ross, he's making the motion.
I make the motion that we keep the hearing open until January meeting.
January 13th.
Yeah. Second.
All right, David has second to keep the public hearing open until January 13th. We will continue the public hearings on the 13th of January. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed say nay. Nay. Okay. Carol, you have your marching orders now. Okay. We have
Vivian?
Yes, David.
Let's ask Carol how she feels with her feet this close to the fire.
I don't know. It's fine. I'll do the best I can. I knew this meeting tonight was going to be impossible to get through everything.
You did very well. I appreciate it.
Well, those 3 hours is kind of beyond all of our bandwidth, as far as I'm concerned. But anyway, it'll get done somehow or another.
Okay. All right, Carol. We're sorry about that. We are hoping that they will give you the extension. I know that has been a concern. Sometimes we'll talk.
Yeah.
Okay, so we don't have any unfinished business. We have no new business. David proposed, yes. So let's go back to David. You had a motion, David, earlier.
Let me repeat that motion, President Vivian.
Yes.
When I was on the Planning Commission years ago, in another iteration, I missed a meeting because of issues, personal issues. At the following meeting, President Cernebaker asked for a retroactive excused absence, and the motion was passed. So at this time, I move to grant a retroactive excused absence to Terry Graff for the September 21 Planning Commission meeting absence.
Okay.
So second.
I think he actually missed the September 9th one.
The September 2021.
Of 2021. Okay. I misunderstood. I was cut out there. Okay. So I have a motion. Did someone second it?
I second.
Okay. Austin seconds it. To retroactively excuse Terry for missing the meeting in September. All those in favor say aye.
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 Okay. All opposed say nay.
Nay.
Yeah, okay. That sounds like that stomping. Okay. Another thing, I will be gone in November. Carol will be gone in November, right, Carol?
No, I'm always available by Zoom.
Oh, okay. At any rate, do we have anything on the agenda, Carol?
No.
The November meeting is on the 11th. That is Veterans Day. So Carol suggested we might not have a meeting on November 11th. Or pick a different date. It's a holiday.
If there's nothing on the agenda, why have the meeting?
Okay.
Agreed.
I agree.
Sharon?
We could have a meeting to pardon a turkey.
Okay. Go away, David. Pardon a turkey? Huh, we still got a couple of weeks. Are you okay with that, Sharon?
Yes.
Okay. So we will not meet on November 11th, and we will be back December 9th, and with the turkey that David has pardoned. Do we have any concerns of the commission? I know, Terry, you had something.
Yeah, and I'll make it quick. I want everybody to Google Picasso, like the painter, timeshares. There's been a new company that's been formed, and they could be a biggest headache for us as Picasso was. And what Picasso was doing is that they buy these expensive houses, like one on Ocean Avenue here, and then they buy it in an LLC, and then they sell 8 shares to 8 different families. And this company was formed in 2020, and as all of you know, I live in the Napa Sonoma Valley, and there's signs all over town now, Stop Picasso, because what they're doing is going in and buying these houses, selling the shares, and they're turning into a nightmare. And the city of St. Helena, which is right in the heart of Napa Valley, has filed a lawsuit against Picasso because the city has a no timeshare ordinance. And so it's going to court, and Picasso is saying we aren't a timeshare, we're something else. So I guess what I'd like is Chad to kind of look into this, or the city attorney, to see if we want to adopt a no timeshare ordinance in residential areas for Gerhardt, because this is going to come to Gerhardt. So Google it and look at the comments about it and what's going on. But I do think it's something we should think about.
So it's PicassoTimeshares.com?
No, I just go on Google and Google
Picasso.com.
Not .com, and it tells you the history of the company, and it tells you what they're doing, and how the communities are reacting. And but they've really hit the Napa Valley hard, because there's a lot of expensive houses there, and they buy them, and then it's like selling wine in a bottle. You know, they can sell it for $10 million when they have to pay $2 million for the house. So take a look at it. But Chad, I'd like to red flag that with you and maybe talk to you about it further, because this lawsuit in St. Helena will be important, because the judge will decide whether they're a timeshare company or not. So anyway.
Will do, Terry. I think that's also called fractional ownership. And it would make it very, very difficult for code enforcement officers to be able to figure out what was really going on.
Well, I'd hate to see it come here, but I think it's inevitable. So that's my concern.
Thank you, Terry. Chad, you can't see it, but the rest of us can see it, that all of a sudden Chad came back on the screen. So it did get his attention. anything else from any of the other commissioners? Any other concerns? I'm seeing shaking of heads. All right. Oh, there is November meeting date on my schedule. We already took care of that. Thank you, everyone. It is 9:22. I am going to adjourn the meeting. Everyone, have a great Thanksgiving, holidays. Chad, what did you want to say something?
I too will have a nice holiday. Thank you. No, I didn't ask.
All right, everyone have nice holidays. I'm going to go cruising, and I will see you in December. Good night.
Thank you all.
Thank you. Enjoy something.
Am I logged in? Can I do that? I mustn't be logged in. Do I say hooray? That means this is my last planning.
I was just going to come in and say I wasn't going to say anything to anybody.
Thank you.
I thought I would keep it quiet.
Thank you.
But oh boy, you go out with a bang.
Hey, I just go out quiet.
I thought you might want to. Okay, good.
Yeah, I'm thrilled. Right.
My brother's waiting for me at my house. He's actually driving home tonight.
Oh my God.
Well, he works nights, so this is his, yeah, so he wanted to.
He's Pendleton.
No, this is my brother in Chehalis, so it's only a couple hours away.
A couple hours, okay.
Yeah.
All right.
So I'm going
to. Well, I am exhausted, so.
As am I.
I am going to.
But you know what? The Reese's Peanut Butter Cup helped. Would you like one?
Not right now, but thank you. I'm going to put this online and go home, so. Oh, I guess I should turn that off. Damn it.